Hello, everyone, and welcome to Perception Talk Radio, where the truth is found when you finally ask the correct questions. Believe it or not, this is my first truly live broadcast, and so I thought I'd do it right. We have a special guest tonight with us this evening, someone you already know and love, author of Babylon Rising and The First Shall Be Last, and also Archon Invasion, The Rise, Fall, and Return of the Nephilim, and the host of the Revolutionary Radio Project here on Truth Frequency Radio. Yes, it's Rob Skiba, everyone. How you doing, Rob?
Hey, John, how are you?
How was that for a long intro?
Dude, you're like, you're taking a massively huge chance bringing me on as your first guest. You may tank your first, like the Titanic, man. We're going down, dude. Iceberg, dead ahead.
Well, you know, I have a backup. Just arriving here earlier this evening from the planet Tatooine at a cost of 300,000 space credits. I think he's defrosted from the carbonite. Are you warmed up, sir?
I am warmed up.
Yep, it's Space Cowboy Mark Sargent.
And just so you know, I don't know if I'm going to be a good backup either, because you know Rob may tank it, but if Windows 10 gives me trouble, then you'll be talking. It's like, hey, what do you say? What do you think, Mark? And you'll just hear dead air. It'll be awful. So if I disappear, you'll know why.
Well, I figured you know if we're going to crash and burn, we should all go down together. So just like the Titanic, I think that's a good analogy. But actually, I'm kind of like the odd man out because I'm usually the wingman on this. And I'll be the first one to say that I'm not an authority on the flat earth topic. You gentlemen have done your research and put together a lot of material on it. So I thought having you both on to discuss would be important, especially Rob. I think this is your first debut back on a live broadcast for interview.
I'm trying to think. I just did my show again. I don't think I've been on anybody else's show since I kind of took it was a short break.
Yeah.
I had sort of a meltdown like on August 16th. I'm like, that's it. Screw everybody. I'm done. You know, I remember something Mark said a while back. He said the first rule of Flat Club is you don't talk about Flat Club.
Yep.
Now yep. I understand.
And you know what? To be honest with you, nobody would fault you, not so much for the topic of conversation, but for the people and the infighting and everything that comes with it. I think there's certain demands placed. You know, we're all looking for the truth, but some people put demands that are really too great for us to give them the answer they want or whatever. And so, you know, it takes a lot from your personal life to go up against that criticism. But I think you've done brilliantly. You put out a lot of new material, and I think you're going to reveal some new links. And, well, I'm going to let you tell it. Why don't you go ahead and tell the audience what you've been working on.
Well, like I said, I got to go back to April 13th. That was the first time I ever heard of Mark Sargent, and I heard him on Canary Cry Radio. I downloaded it. That was about an hour and a half long show, and I had about an hour and a half long drive to go to where I was doing my taxes. So I'm listening to this thinking this is just like an April Fool's joke or something at first, you know, rolling my eyes. And then at the end of it, I'm going, well, shoot, some of that made sense.
Did you check the calendar? Was it April 1st?
It was April 13th.
Okay.
just a few days. Yeah, it was. Well, I don't remember what day they actually did the broadcast. That's the thing, because it was like it was an archive broadcast.
It was like Groundhog Day. It was April 1st, a week later.
It could be. So after going and doing my taxes, I thought, yeah, I'm going to listen to this again. So I listened to it on the drive back. And then I'm like, come on, you know, this really? So I start doing some research on my own. And now, before I even listened to that, I had people on my Facebook page hounding me for months trying to get me to look into it. And I had the same reaction everybody does. What are you, crazy? This is stupid. It's the 21st century. This is insane. Come on, knock it off. But after hearing Mark on Canary Cry and then watching Flat Earth Clues and several other videos that, of course, populate in the suggested videos column there on YouTube.
Sure.
I was very intrigued, and at first I kind of set out to debunk it, and did like a lot of people do. We have all seen the pictures, right, from space, but as soon as you start looking into that, you find out they are either all composite images or paintings or just outright fraudulent or questionable at best.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next thing I did, I come from a very much a Christian background, so I consulted the scriptures, my source for truth, right? And anytime I do this type of research, I really try, it's hard because we all have our own personal biases, but I try to come at it as freshly as I can. You know, I'm like, okay, I'm gonna put all preconceived notions aside, and I'm just going to read the text and see what it says, as if I'd never heard anything about a ball or globe or sphere or anything. And Well, at that point, I was stuck because you cannot get a spinning heliocentric globe ball out of the scriptures. You just can't. And I tried every which way to see if I could, and it's not there. And at that point, I was stuck because I've built my entire ministry on saying the Bible is my source for truth and I can take it literally. But if you take the Bible literally, welcome to the Flat Earth Club. You can't get out of it. And it gets even worse if you happen to dabble in some of what I call a biblically endorsed extra-biblical text, such as the Book of Enoch, which is an absolute slam dunk for the Flat Earthers.
Now, I want to say something. You just gave me a thought on this. I know a lot of times in forums, whether it's conspiracy circles, whatever, whenever somebody brings up the Christian aspect, there are those people who are atheists or agnostics. They roll their eyes and say, oh, I'm not even going to listen if you're going to start quoting scripture and so on and so forth. Sure. However, if it's proven that the earth is flat, I think it's going to bring atheists, agnostics, and Christians together on the same level playing field, so to speak, because now we have to address, as the whole human populace, okay, now where the heck are we? Because before, we were all kind of coexisting, even disagreeing, on a round earth, right? Yeah. But now with limitations of a flat playing field and possibly a dome containing us, we have to start looking at this as if, the Christians are going to have to ask, well, why did God put us in a dome, in a containment? Atheists and agnostics will say, why is there a physical structure around us? What is this reality? Not to detract from what you're saying, but how does that tie in? Because you mentioned Exodus. What solidifies it for you now with the Bible?
Book of Enoch.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Well, to your point, though, when I said, screw it, I'm done, let me just kind of back up and address that real quick, because I have been on the public scene since about 2010, very outspoken on radio shows and whatnot about different subjects. And there's no shortage of controversial topics that I have dealt with over the years. In fact, it seems like everything I look into happens to be controversial. And any type of controversial subject is going to bring a certain measure of resistance. But I have to say, nothing has the level of resistance that this does. And it's not just pushback. It's like vitriol. It is like, and I joke about it. I'm like, if you want to see a freak show, just mention to somebody that you're looking into it and watch what happens. Bring popcorn because you're in for a show.
Oh, yeah.
Because people will definitely get in touch with their inner psycho almost instantaneously right in front of you.
Yeah.
And, it at first it's kind of amusing, but when you get attacked like on a regular basis with, 10, 12, 15, 20 people a day calling you every name under the sun, and, they say sticks and stones may, that whole thing. You know what? Words do hurt. And when that's all you hear, the very vocal minority, you finally just like, what? This isn't worth it, So I August 16th, I'm like, okay, I'm done. But then a really crazy, cool thing happened. I got flooded with emails and phone calls and Facebook messages and all kinds of stuff, and very supportive. And a lot of people are like, what are you doing, man? Because I've put out probably 20 hours worth of videos now, and I don't know, however many hundred pages of stuff.
Can I say something real quick? I think I actually went on one of your channels on your YouTube, and I said something like, Jesus will forgive you more than once. I said, but the internet is less forgiving. You can flounce only maybe once. And then it's like the boy who cried wolf. So I'm glad you've come back.
Yeah,
I think a lot of people are.
Well, thank you. And that was the message that came back is like, hey man, what are you doing? We love your site. We love what you're doing. We may not agree, and I don't even agree with everything yet. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm a questioning globalist. However, my evidence for it is rapidly dwindling to almost nothing.
Not to be confused with the globalist elite.
Well, that word has taken on a brand new meaning for me.
Right.
The whole globalist agenda, it really has. But when I got, just so much positive, encouraging emails and testimonies, and you want to talk about atheists, I had several, probably at least a half dozen or more, write to me that have said to me that they have either now been open to the idea of entertaining that there may be a God out there, or have given their life completely over to them and had a radical life change, and they're like, dude, you can't stop, So that really surprised me. Of all the topics, that would reach an atheist, that would be it. But I've had lots of them. In fact, it prompted me to put together a page just dedicated to testimonies. And if anybody's interested, they go to testingtheglobe.com/testimonies.html. And that's just a handful. That's just what I had time to cut and paste the day I put that page up.
And you know what? I think the reason why people get so upset, or like you said, like they react so violently against this subject, is because unlike finding out that you're paying too much in taxes or the New World Order is controlling every aspect of your life, a lot of people will just shrug their shoulders and say, well, that's just the way it's always been. This topic, you can't just shrug your shoulders. You can't just shrug it off. Because like yourself, like Mark, and Mark, you may want to comment on this, you would have dispelled this. You would have proven it for what it is, but you haven't. Nobody has.
Yeah. I would have if I could have. And if I might interject just what Rob was saying, Star Gods, I think, voiced it pretty well, which was he goes, the being open-minded, people will say they're open-minded all they want. He goes, I got something that'll test you. It's called flat earth spray. And you spray it in their face and you see what happens. And you'll find it if they're really open-minded or not. Because yeah, what he was saying, there's people, they can say what they want. Oh yeah, I'm into this. I'm into that. Flat earth comes along and everybody just steals their jaw. And it's like, gets angry. And what you were saying about just the rage that comes through. It's amazing.
Yeah, that's just, to me, it has to be more than just cognitive dissonance.
Yeah.
There's got to be something, if I may say so, a spiritual aspect to it, because there is, it's like a demonic something just comes out of people. And from the Christian perspective that I come from, I'm kind of putting people on the carpet right now saying, look, I listen to people say this all the time from the pulpit, whether you're talking about a pastor or a quote-unquote Bible scholar or what have you, evangelist. A lot of people are prone to saying that they take the Bible literally. So I posted something on my Facebook page. I said, okay, next time you hear one of these guys say they take the Bible literally, ask them if they believe in the still, flat, circular, enclosed earth under a dome set on pillars within which the sun, moon, and stars were placed on day four of creation. Because, I mean, that's what it's going to come down to. If you say, you either have to throw out that whole idea of taking the Bible literally, yeah, or if you're going to say you take it literally, then you're going to have to deal with that. And everybody in their talking parrot went, Isaiah 40:22. I'm like, look, circle means circle. Go on Google.
Oh, you circle. You got to phrase that one. You got to tell us what that one is, by the way, just so the audience knows.
Yeah, that he sits on the circle of the earth.
Yeah.
And, in fact, I'm going to just go ahead and pull it up here.
Punch it up.
Yeah,
because I've heard you mention with the parrot. In fact, I saw you put the parrot graphic up there, and I was going, I guarantee you're going to bring it up tonight.
Yeah, well, this is the one that everybody will use, and yeah, the whole verse is: "It is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth, and the inhabitants thereof are as grasshoppers, that stretcheth out the heavens as a curtain, and spreads them out as a tent to dwell in."
Yeah.
Well, there's a number of things wrong with using that verse to support the idea of a globe. First of all, circle does not mean sphere.
Yeah.
And of all the authors out there that had written about the nature of the earth, Isaiah, interestingly enough, is the only guy who used the word for ball. And he used it in chapter 22, verse 18. He says, "He will surely violently turn and toss thee like a ball into a large country." Okay, and the Hebrew word there is dur. Versus chug, which is the word used in chapter 40, verse 22. Yeah. So, I made a meme of this. I did a Google search for circle and clicked images so you can see all what a circle is for people who have trouble understanding English. Go and click on Google and put ball, click images, and see what shows up for ball. And I put them side by side, and I said, Isaiah knew the difference. Do you? because there is a difference in – over and over, and Isaiah's the last guy to write about it. Before that, you got Solomon, you got Job, you got Moses. I mean, several other people had written prior to Isaiah and gave you more detail. And in Proverbs, it says that the circle is inscribed. Well, if you look up the word for inscribed, it's chakak, which means to like engrave in stone, like carve the Ten Commandments. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know how you engrave a ball into something, but I can see how you can engrave a circle.
And I want to say something else to that. You know, with the Bible, again, if you're an agnostic or an atheist, I would suggest that you view it simply from a historic perspective, in that people back then, they didn't just write things down like we have tabloids or Instagram and stuff, right? When they wrote something, they meant it. They had to pass that knowledge on or pass it down to the next generation. So even if you don't have a fundamentalist belief or a spiritual belief or whatever, look at the Bible in the context in which it's written and from when it's written. And from that perspective, you know, why would they put this in here otherwise?
Well, you make a great point on context, because the entire ancient Near East, I mean, I come from, a Christian background, so I'm looking at the Judeo-Christian, you know, the Hebrew scriptures.
Right, right.
But they were not the only ones. They were just a group of people in the Levant, you know. The entire ancient Near East had the same idea, and there's variations on how they depicted it. But they all believed it that way. And I just was looking into something today regarding the writings of the early church fathers, and just looking up the word firmament and how people understood the firmament. And universally, they understood it as a dome, as a metallic dome at that. It was a hard structure. You can't get around it. I mean, and this is coming from some of these cultures. We have to keep in mind, we're building huge megalithic structures that to this day, with all our modern science, we can't figure out how they did it. So we have to throw out the idea that the further back we go, the stupider they are. I mean, we think we're so smart we came from monkeys. How smart are we? If you go further back, they're more advanced, you know, than we are.
And you know the pyramids, bringing them up real quick, they've continued to be a mystery. I was working with a gentleman one time. He was a geologist and paleontologist. And he said to me a noted fact that all the pharaohs that were buried in them were buried in successive order, in descending successive order, in the biggest to the smallest. Now, he said, if you're going to build a pyramid as the next pharaoh or king, you would want to outdo the guy before you and build a bigger one. But that didn't seem to be the case. So, you know, where did the pyramids come from? Who built them? And then, like you're saying, who built possibly these other structures or the foundation of the earth itself? And I mean, there's so many mysteries we don't know.
And these guys who are doing this stuff believed we're in an enclosed, flat world.
What I really want to see, and I brought this up on Mark's show, and maybe this will apply as we keep talking about the Bible, this show, is how they can map the heavens or the stars or the astrology and apply it from a flat earth to a circular earth perspective and have it coordinate the same. You know what I mean? Like have it all align the same, because something should be off.
Like you're saying that the ship got back when the earth was flat.
Right.
You could cross oceans and everybody got to where they wanted to go, more or less. And then when it went to a globe, why wasn't there a complete revamping of the navigation system?
Right. You think everything would be off, right? Constellations and the way they navigated and what they were marking down. And again, you know, what do you think on this, Rob?
Well, that's one of the arguments that I hear all the time from people who do navigate the oceans, you know, on a regular basis, be it their job or by hobby. And they're saying, you know, with the type of navigation we do, it's only possible on the globe. I'm like, well, that's kind of funny, because you don't have spherical maps that you're plotting on a flat map. And somehow the ancients managed to travel the whole thing, you know, and map it out. And they did so with the mindset that it was flat. So, you know, I don't think the argument works. Now, I'm not smart enough in that field. I have no experience in it. But, you know, when people are using sextants and stuff like that, and they're using it to figure out the size and distance of the sun, it doesn't come out to 93 million miles away.
Yeah. You know? And we may in the future have a guest who's more familiar with that, including, again, the alignment of certain structures like the pyramids or other things they measured, like you said, on land, or even like the Nazca lines. I think those big animal drawings, you know, that you can only see from the air. They look like eagles and different things. And you have to wonder what perspective, what tools, what were they going by? And did they account for a curved earth when they were doing so?
I just recently was looking into the astrolabe.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure if I said that right. Yeah, astrolabe, I think, is how it is. But that whole thing looks like it's a plotted measurement device that would work just as well on a flat plane, as I understand it. but I had created a – I was – because I'm getting a lot of questions, you know, and I'm like, how did I all of a sudden – I don't know anything. I'm still trying to figure this stuff out myself, you know. But I'm tenacious. It's like, when I get on a subject, I got to figure it out, you know? And so I'm really trying to dig into everything that I have questions about. And one of them is, you know, how do the four seasons work and, you know, the long nights and long days and in the various, you know, places on the earth in the Arctic and Antarctic. And so I've had this software that I've used for years for other purposes called Stellarium. It's a free software your people can download, and it allows you to track the movement of the sun, moon, and stars, past, present, and future. And you can set your date and time as well as your location in this software. And there's a whole lot of options that you can use with it, including different ways of, like, different types of lenses, as if the screen that you're looking through is looking through a different type of lens.
Okay.
And as I messed around with it, I set my location to Antarctica. And, you know, it was showing it going across the screen, going across the screen, because I was basically just looking in one of the cardinal directions, you know, north, south, east, or west. But I wanted to see all four. So you can kind of pull the camera back, so it's like this fisheye lens effect, so you have north, south, east, and west all the way around you. And I played around with it and the different types of cameras that you can use in it, and got it figured out so that I can watch the movement of the sun and moon for the whole year overhead. Now, when you do it that way, it's going counterclockwise over you. But I noticed that it was doing some really interesting things, because it was following a wider circuit and then tightening up to a smaller circuit. Mm-hmm. And so then I got rid of the sky. You can make the sky disappear, make the stars disappear, make the ground disappear. So all I was looking at was the sun and moon against a black background doing its thing.
Okay. Okay.
And it's going counterclockwise. So I went ahead and recorded a whole year. I started January 1, 2015, went right through the end of December. And after I got it recorded, I brought it into my video software, and I can punch the black background out and put it over the classical flat earth map. And then all I did was flip it horizontally, so it's not going counterclockwise, it's going clockwise now, because I'm looking down on it as opposed to looking up on it. You know, so I'm looking down on it on the map. And when I did that, I was absolutely amazed at what happened, because here's this globe-based heliocentric software perfectly illustrated, at least to my satisfaction, in my mind anyway, how the four seasons work on the flat earth map. And what really astonished me is, after I did that, I decided to compare January with June. Mm-hmm. And what you see is the sun is on a much tighter circle on the flat earth map in June. And it was the other way around. I forget which way, whatever way it was.
Right, right.
And the other one, it was on a much wider circuit. So in other words, closer to Antarctica in one and closer to the North Pole in the other. But what really astonished me is it actually speeds up. The sun actually speeds up because I have June and January perfectly synced. So you see that, you know, January 1 and June 1 and the hours in sync. So it's the hours, the time is in sync. But the only way the sun could maintain the same 24-hour time period in sync with June would be for it to speed up. And that's exactly what the software did. I didn't do anything.
It almost sounds like Swiss precision, as if the whole thing is a mechanical or a clock.
It's a clock.
I saw that animation you made, by the way, Rob. It was brilliant. When I saw what you recorded there, and I was going, wait, what am I looking at? And by the time the year had done, had finished, I was going, holy smokes. Yeah, exactly what I thought. I was going, this thing is very, very well built.
Yeah, I just had a hunch, I had a theory, tried it out, and it just worked like clockwork. You know, it's going, yeah. Holy cow, that's amazing.
Well, let me ask you this, because we're coming up on 1 minute till the break. What vantage point, because now we're talking about space a bit here and the moon and other things, what vantage point do you think is finally going to solidify whether we live on a flat or a round Earth? That is, do we need to go into space, and if so, are they preventing us from? Because men of industry, men of technology, like everybody from Tesla to the Wright brothers, everybody's made advancements, right, at every level, even the German scientists. But for some reason, Elon Musk, none of these guys, I mean, what, they had a bunch of failures with the SpaceX program. Nobody's getting up into space. So I'll pose it to both of you guys. Do you think the answer is going to be found here on Earth, or is it going to be found when we finally get up at a certain altitude?
Well,
go ahead,
30 Rob. Seconds. Go.
Do it 30 seconds. Never going to do it.
I'm just going to say, looking at the time, that's not going to be.
No, we can come back and talk about this, but I just want to see.
After the break.
no, what do you think? Sky or Earth? Do you think we're going to figure it out, or you think NASA's going to spill the beans?
I don't trust NASA as far as I can throw them.
We can do this late at night, right? We can act as crazy as we want.
Yeah.
So yeah, you had a loaded question.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
Wait, loaded? What?
Yeah.
Okay.
Nice. The question was, thank you. Why would you shoot me? Shoot him.
No, I was just shooting in the air. Go ahead.
The question was, how do you think this thing's going to be revealed finally to the public? Is it going to be one of those things that the public's going to have to, you know, force people into space? Or is it going to happen on the ground? Is it a combination of both? Any thoughts on this, Rob?
Yeah, well, what has really intrigued me about this is you keep hearing all these rumors about NASA either themselves or teaming up with another organization to get civilians up there.
Yeah.
And, I mean, you know, from the flat earther side, I'd be a bit nervous because if you're putting all your eggs in the basket that it's flat and they sent you up there, well, there you go. I mean, but my questions I would have about that, first of all, I'd be, because some people are out there, well, we should do a Kickstarter campaign to get you up on the next. I'm like, look, these things are blowing up. I really want to go up on the next space race. As much as I would love to get into space, it was my childhood dream, until they stop blowing up, it's not something I'm going to be too interested in. But I'll tell you, I have seen footage. There was a German rocket that went up a couple months ago. And it got up to, I believe it was about 75 miles, 73 miles, something like that. Yep. And it had cameras on it. It's spinning around, and it's flat, man. When you see, the problem is people are using all these fisheye lenses. And a fisheye lens is going to be pretty close to accurate whenever the subject or whatever you're looking at is across the center of the lens. But as soon as that camera tilts up or down, it's all warped out of whack. And, you know, you get concave, convex, you know, the Earth is the incredible morphing blob. So this particular thing, a rocket, when the horizon went across center, it's flat at 73 freaking miles.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I've seen the weather balloon stuff up to like 130,000 feet. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that stuff's flat as a pancake. And I saw another one that was about 60 miles, if I remember, that was shot way back in the beginning with a V2 rocket. It was black and white footage, and the thing's going up there, and as it starts to tumble back down and the horizon goes across the center, it's flat. Black and white footage, V2 rocket.
Yep.
So at this point, I'm looking at this saying, of all the information that we have, barring NASA, the government, and the military, of the and that goes for any government or military in the world, barring all that, the only information we have is from experiments like the ones I just talked about or civilians sending up weather balloons. And in every single case so far that I have seen, in fact, somebody just posted on my Facebook page, you've probably seen it going around, teenager floats 30-pound camera into space to capture curvature of the Earth.
Right.
Problem is, if you click on that video and watch it, as soon as that horizon goes across the center of the screen, it's flat.
Yeah.
So, I mean, everybody in the beginning was like, oh, if you've ever flown on an airplane, you've seen the curvature. Bam! Sorry. They don't get above 40,000 feet, civilian planes, so ain't nobody seen the curvature. I would have said it myself. You know, I've traveled the world many times. I would have said, yeah, sure, I've seen the curvature of the Earth. That's because my brain told me I did, but now that I'm out there looking for it, anytime I've been up in a plane since April, I'm taking pictures out my window, bringing it into the Photoshop, put a parallel bar across it. It's flat as a pancake.
Bingo.
Can I say something to that real quick?
Yeah.
Even though it's my show, right? I have to ask.
No, you can't.
I'm a photographer, so I know exactly what you're speaking of. And I show people when I shoot their picture, especially with a 16x35 wide lens, how you can change the perspective and force it and do all crazy things with it. And like you said, you turn it and it gets all wonky. However, a lot of people believe, you know, they say seeing is believing, right? So in terms of going into space, there's a certain sense of weightlessness, right? We're always told you go into space, you float, right? Well, I've seen the same phenomenon in water, right? Our own astronauts float in water, right?
Yep.
Falling from space, well, you're falling because the gravity is bringing you back into Earth. Okay, well, I've also seen deep sea divers, when they go beyond a certain point, the water just pulls them down really fast. So I guess what I'm getting at is, you know, seeing is believing. We don't know what's up there just by sending a camera, right? We don't know what... But
cameras are, at best, they're inconclusive.
That's what I mean, yeah.
Because of the types of lenses and whatnot. But I will say, from what I have seen so far, anybody who thinks that they've seen the curvature of the Earth at anything below 70 miles, you're on crack. It's not there. you're convincing yourself that it's there, but it's not. And that's proven by, as soon as the camera, that the object goes across the center of the lens, man, it's flat. And that's showing it as true as that type of lens can show it. So my question would be then, okay, if we actually physically go up into some kind of craft or whatever, with SpaceX or something, NASA in the future, what type of windows are they going to have?
There you go. And what disclosure agreements are they going to have to sign?
Right.
And how high would they even be allowed to go up anyway? You know, are they going to go up 70 miles, or are they just going to skim, you know, they're going to go, not that it would matter anyway, because if there's no curvature, like you said, if there's no curvature with the weather balloons at 120, 130,000 feet, there's no curvature at 70 miles. Look, if there's no curvature at 70 miles, you're not going to see it at 100. You know, you're probably not going to see it at 200, because it's probably not there at all. And to your point, Johnathan, yeah, sometimes it doesn't necessarily tell us what we see, but it does tell us what we don't see, which is at this point, and you know me, I like a little bit of a curve or a warp in my model. I haven't seen anything. I haven't seen any curve, even the slightest amount of curve. So, you know, is it possible that the pure flat earthers were right along? This thing's tabletop flat. It's very possible.
But that said, I mean, if there's a dome, though, if there's a firmament, right?
Yeah.
What altitude do you think it's at? And what is the composition up there that's creating this so-called space? Because even our own atmosphere, right? You know, people think, oh, we breathe oxygen. It's like, yeah, but that's only like, what, 12 to 20%? It's mostly nitrogen. Yeah. Like, what is space even comprised of? Or, you know what I mean? So you get to that ceiling level, and then what? Maybe at that ceiling level, you're only going so high, you can't see beyond the horizon, or, you know, the extent of how flat the Earth is, because it's too shallow. It's kind of like when you go up in a tall building and you try to see down to the street, you have to put your face right against the glass to get that perspective. But
yeah, well, I mean, if you go by, and Rob should chime in on this, but if you go by what Jeffrey Grupp, you know, who is on Strange World a while back, he says, you know, that the dome / firmament is way bigger than most people thinks it is. You know, it's like a salad bowl over the top of a coin. It stretches way, way out. But that's just, you know, he's speculating, but I like where he's going with it.
Yeah, I built a model just recently. In fact, for the sake of this conversation and wherever we may go with it, you can go ahead and go to I just built a page literally 10 minutes before we got on the air. I finished it. But if you go to testingtheglobe.com/3D model. That's a new model that I've been working on based on the text. I'm trying to conceptualize what I'm reading in the various texts and doing the best I can with it. Now, I didn't show it particularly expansive. It's probably a lot more shallow than it actually is. Because as I got to thinking about this after I built the model about a week ago, it's got to be quite a bit bigger. The dome has to be quite a bit bigger than what I have depicted here for the planets to make any sense. Stars are a whole other issue. And I'll tell you, some of the things that have kept me clinging to the standard model, if you will, were things that I couldn't explain at first, at least when I was looking into it. That was things like the Coriolis effect, the lunar eclipse, comets and meteors and asteroids and that sort of thing. I didn't quite know what to do with that stuff. But then I started doing a lot of looking into the works of Tesla and the ether, and all the ether stuff seemed to really, at least in my mind, settle the Coriolis effect. Then I found a whole bunch of ancient writings regarding these dark orbs, if you will. You know, modern science is always talking about dark matter. Well, in particular, it was in the Hindu writings of these dark orbs that are also part of our system. And it was their belief that was what caused the eclipses, or at least the lunar eclipse anyway. solar eclipse, if it's the moon going in front of it, I mean, okay, fine. It still works in the flat Earth model. But the lunar eclipse was a big, big one to try to figure out. And then when I was reading Zetetic Astronomy and several other books, they back in the 1800s, from 1865 to about 1901, there were several people writing about this stuff. And, of course, Samuel Robertum did Zetetic Astronomy. And in that book, it was either that one or Terra Firma, I forget which, but whatever. They had several, quite a number, actually, of documented historical cases as recently as the 1800s of lunar eclipses, going blood-red lunar eclipse while the sun was still up on the horizon. Wow. So right there, that immediately obliterated the modern science view of how the moon turns blood red. You know, everybody's talking about the next blood moon coming up, and it's supposedly when it goes into the – as the cone part of the shadow of the Earth, you know, you got the sun on one area, the moon moon's on the other side of the Earth, and the Earth's in the middle, and it goes into that cone shape of the Earth's shadow on the other side. That's what supposedly makes the blood moon. But that doesn't work if the sun's still up. And there have been several historical cases. So I was like, okay, I mean, these are documented cases that I guess people could look up in old newspapers or whatever. That's what he was quoting. So I had to look for another alternative. You know, okay, if that's not how the lunar eclipse happens, how does it happen? And that's when I stumbled across some ancient writings, and I forget the names of them. But anyway, that, at least in my mind, solved that problem. But then I had the issue of the comets and the asteroids and the planets and all that. How does that work? And, you know, if we're in a dome, then obviously they're still there. I mean, we've seen them. I've looked at them through telescopes. I've seen the moons of Jupiter and the rings of Saturn. They're there. But they would have to be much closer and way smaller than what we have been told. And it seemed like they'd have to be almost too small to work in the domed idea that I had anyway. That's when I started thinking it's got to be a bigger dome for the planets to work. But then I stumbled on a YouTube channel, and I watched 4 hour-and-a-half long videos that just absolutely blew my mind. And these videos are done from a globalist perspective. However, if you just take what they're talking about and kind of slide it over into the flat Earth model, it solves a lot of problems, at least for me. And the YouTube channel is Thunderbolts Project. So if you just go to YouTube and look up the user Thunderbolts Project, all I can say is wow. But it's dealing with the plasma electric universe concept, and they totally debunk the whole idea that comets are, you know, lumpy ice balls of, you know, frozen water and dirt and whatever. They obliterate that whole thing.
I have a feeling I'm going to be up till 4 a.m. after this show.
You'll be up for – I was. I stumbled on that first video, and I was like, what? And then I just kept watching them after that.
How long ago did he make them, if you don't mind me chiming in real quick?
One that I just looked at, Thunderbolts of the Gods, official movie. I just pulled it up while we were talking, December 23rd, 2012.
Oh, okay.
So these guys have been around for at least a few years. And I think their website's thunderboltsproject.info or thunderbolts.info or something like that.
And by the way, real quick, I mentioned your books earlier. I have to look them up. I have to read them, actually. Do you remember there was another movie, too, that somebody was making 3-4 years ago? I think it was on the Anunnaki, and then supposedly it just disappeared. Are you familiar with that?
Well, there was the one that was sort of the Aliens prequel.
Okay, maybe that's on it. I didn't know if it tied in with this at all, but I remember it just came to mind. Ignore me.
Prometheus was the Prometheus. Is that the one you're talking about?
No. There was an actual movie called Anunnaki, but it got scrapped.
they'd never allow that to get made, man.
Yeah, no, it looked really legit. It looked like there was some production value to it, and then it just got pulled.
Well, Prometheus was basically that.
Yeah, without saying it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Without coming out and saying it. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you know, one by one, a lot of the arguments that I had before are kind of being whittled away. You know, the more I look into it. And that's the thing, you know, that's what I tell everybody. You know, they say condemnation before investigation is the height of ignorance. And there's a ton of people out there perched atop Mount Ignorance throwing rocks in glass houses. And I'm like, guys, take a day, just one day, to look into one area that you got questions about. Because if you actually do that, you'll find that there's not just one answer and there's nothing else. I mean, even in the modern globalist community, heliocentric globe model, the geocentric model, I'll tell you what, even on the geocentric globe, I'll tell you now, I am pretty square, about 99% sold on the geocentric idea that we are not moving. Whether we're flat or a ball, we're not moving. And that supports Scripture. Scripture tells you that. Scripture says, you know, it's stationary, set on pillars. So with this model that I built here, and I built this model and put it together in segments, sort of with cutaways, after reading the Book of Enoch again, I'm in the process of putting out an edition of the Book of Enoch with extensive footnotes and commentary. But when I started that project a little over a year ago, I was still very much in the heliocentric globe model. Now that I'm entertaining the still flat on pillars circular earth model under a dome, looking at the Book of Enoch, I'm like, holy cow, especially when you get to chapter 89. Chapter 89 starts off, chapter 89, verse 2. And again, this is Enoch, who's had a vision of the coming judgment of the flood. And he's telling it to his son. This is the dream that I had. And he says, and again, I raised mine eyes towards heaven and saw a lofty roof with seven water torrents thereon. And those torrents flowed with much water into an enclosure. and I saw again, and behold, fountains were opened on the surface of that great enclosure. And that water began to swell and rise upon the surface. And I saw that enclosure till all its surface was covered with water. The flood that everybody on this, whatever we want to call it, earth, everybody's got some kind of legend, myth, story of the flood, is a whole lot easier to explain and makes a whole lot more sense if you're basically filling up a bathtub.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, than trying to flood a ball.
That's a good point. Wait a minute. I feel stupid again.
Yeah, 40 days of rain ain't going to do it.
Well, not just 40 days of rain, but if you're looking at the earth as a ball, right? And you're saying, let's say the average floodplain area where it got flooded was 50 feet of water, right?
Yeah.
You're saying the whole circumference of the earth increased by 50 feet from inward out with water.
Yeah.
Does that sound right?
The biblical text says 15 cubits, which is about 20 feet or so, above the highest mountains. Now, we don't know how high they were before the flood.
But I'm saying that water couldn't – it's not like you're squeezing a sponge. It's not like you're getting the water extracted from the earth out, right? You're saying it came down from above.
Well, the fountains of the deep were broken up first, but the windows of heaven were opened.
Right.
And, the Genesis account says this firmament thing shows up to separate water above from water beneath. So effectively what you end up with is a bathysphere. You know, this thing shows up, and then it's like water sucked out of it. So you have a circle, you know, it's an enclosed, pressurized, it's a bathysphere.
Yeah.
And this started to make a whole lot more sense to me, too, as I started to think about things in the pre-flood world. If you've ever listened to or saw the works of Kent Hovind or some of Carl Baugh, some of these other guys, talking about how the fossil record shows everything got way bigger in the pre-flood world, and bubbles and amber that they, you know, drill into, and they find that it's pressurized with a much more pressure than we have now and a lot more saturated oxygen. Mm-hmm. Well, if you've got this water over the bathysphere, that's going to create pressure inside the bathysphere, you know? And if you open up the windows and pour some of that water in and flood it a little bit, you don't need a whole lot. All you need is, because, you know, depending on how big that dome is, it's very little water that has to come out of the top to go down to fill up the bathtub, you know. But that would have decreased the pressure, because some of that water would have left from above you and gone down into you, you know, into the enclosure. Yeah. So to me, I was like, wow, that would explain why there was an atmospheric change after the flood, is because some of that pressurized water that was above has been released. Yeah. Do you follow?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, absolutely.
And they hinted at that. I don't know. Rob, did you ever see the Russell Crowe Noah that came out?
Yeah.
Yeah. They kind of hinted at the end when the rain was falling. It was like the rain was getting harder and harder. And then all of a sudden there was something coming down that was way bigger than rain. It was like, you know, like blimps were just throwing entire rivers of water from up above. Yeah. And you realize there, it's like, well, that's not from clouds. That's from something else. And I thought that was really interesting.
Well, yeah, the biblical record said it had not rained prior to the flood. The world was watered by basically a mist, a dew. So there was no rain like we know it today before the flood. You know, but after that, everything changed. I mean, the whole environment was radically changed. But, you know, as I'm going through all these texts they're making a whole lot more sense because they were written, the people who wrote it were writing from an enclosed, flat, circular Earth model. That was their mindset when they wrote it. So when we try to kind of force our spinning heliocentric globe model onto this text, you have a lot of problems with it. If you're willing to let that go and let the text say what it says, wow, it paints a much different and much clearer story, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I mean, most people, though, believe or, you know, been told that the Earth became round when what? When Galileo discovered it? Or is it prior to that? When he started to say the sun, you know.
Yeah, Pythagoras, some of these early guys had ideas, and Eratosthenes. And, you know, people, you get all these videos being sent to you, you know, 10 reasons why we knew the Earth.
Case closed, 100%, rip.
Case closed. Yeah. And it's like, you know, I look at them now, and even before I even really got started on all of this, I had decided, you know what, I'm going to sort of play devil's advocate with you, Will, or just flip the board and look at the other, you know, look at the chessboard from the flat Earth perspective, yeah. You know, and see if I was a flat earther, how would I argue against these 10 points that we know the Earth is a globe, you know? And I found that, and this is early, this is like April 15th, early, you know, April 16th.
Yeah.
I was able to, I think 8 out of 10 of them were easy to debunk. Mm-hmm. You know, like one of them's like, well, you can make a right angle triangle on a ball. That proves where the Earth is a globe. I'm like, no, it just proves you can do a right angle triangle on a ball. It doesn't prove anything.
Right.
You know, well, I could draw a circle on a pyramid. That must mean the Earth's a pyramid. You know, So what? you know, I mean, I was like, really? That's an argument? And, you know, the number one proof we know the Earth is a globe is we have the pictures. Yeah. And that's where it all fell apart for me. I'm going, no,
oh, man.
We don't have the pictures. That's why I put a video out. This is a small portion of a longer video that I've been kind of piecing together for a while now. But NASA really helped me out a couple months ago when they put out the video, or just recently, I don't even think it's been a month yet. They put out the video where it shows the moon going in front of the Earth.
Oh, yeah.
So we were talking about that earlier today, yeah.
Yeah, the satellite's so supposedly, what, 1 million miles away.
Yep.
And it shows the Earth completely illuminated, which means the sun has to be behind the satellite. Mm-hmm. And then the moon comes between the Earth and the satellite.
Yep.
And goes right across the screen. And there's no shadow. There should be shadow. Now, some people say, well, if the sun's off just by a little bit, the shadow would have gone. Okay, fine. Why are the clouds not moving? This is there's 5 hours of time lapse depicted in that time lapse animation. And the clouds are, and there's like a hurricane just to the west of Mexico. And in 5 hours, that thing's not spinning. It's not, there's no cloud. I could put my camera outside right now, or well, it's dark now, but during the day, and shoot the sky for an hour and show you way more cloud moving than I saw in the 5 hours of that. But all of that aside, the thing that really got me was the scale that they showed.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
The scale. We were talking about that just recently. Go ahead.
It's so bad because, you know, they have the moon scaled to its approximate size to the Earth, about a quarter of the size of the Earth. And that's the way it looks as it's going by. The problem is, the Earth is the moon is 30 Earth diameters away from us.
Yeah.
So you could put 29 Earths, globe Earths, between this one and the moon.
Yeah.
And the satellite's on the other side of the moon looking towards the Earth. And yet the Earth is that big? Really? So I went to software and I created 30 Earths crossed with the moon, the right scale and everything. And I created this 3D animation of what it should look like. And then people are saying, well, the zoom lens is creating this illusion. I'm like, really? That's what you could go with? Because my thing was, if this is the way, and this is the most modern technology, 21st century satellite, you know, 4 megapixel picture, you know, quality, whatever. This is the scale that you're presenting us? Because is that your final answer? Because if it is, we're looking at the satellite's looking at the dark side of the moon, you know, the side that doesn't face the Earth.
Yeah,
if
the side we never see.
We're a little under a minute. Go for it.
If you're standing on the side of the Earth, the side of the moon facing the Earth, taking a picture of the Earth like the Apollo astronauts allegedly did, then the Earth would cover the entire sky. You would not see black anywhere. So yep. They just, in one little short video, they completely shot themselves in the foot and exposed the entire Apollo program as a fraud, and also exposed the Kuglia or whatever Japan footage of Earthrise, any of the footage that we've seen from Europe or anybody else that shows the Earth as small in the distance from the moon. If this modern, most recent NASA footage is correct, they just exposed everybody, including themselves.
And we're going into break, so I want to talk more about that when we come back, because there is that perspective, and it's way out of scale. And it never dawned on me until I saw your video. I was just talking to Mark this morning about it.
Yeah.
And saying, wow, like, as a photographer, I should have caught that. But
you were angry. It's like, why didn't I see that? Yeah.
So, all right, when we come back from break, let's expand on that.
The Earth is round. The Earth is round. The Earth. Oh, wait a minute. This is my reading voice. Hold on.
Sorry, guys. That was my inside voice. It got out.
I knew you had doubts.
Well, I wonder when there's people, when they're first being exposed to this and they're resisting, and it's like, resistance is futile.
Yeah. Yeah, everybody fights it at first, everybody, including me. I've only run into, I think I mentioned you, Jonathan, a few people, very, very few. And I think they were both women that it's like, oh, yeah, I totally accepted it right off the bat. And I look, I go, what's wrong with you? Come on, fight it like everybody else.
Well, this used to be a simple topic to laugh off. I'm telling you, like, the stuff we're talking about that Rob's doing, everybody's doing on this now. It used to be a simple saying, wait a minute, I've seen pictures from space. I've seen a globe. I saw them land on the moon. And that was the end of it. And now it's like, what? Internet science? What?
Before we let Rob roll with this, I've got to mention that it's still strange for me, the fact that we're talking about this, and that we've been talking about this show after show. And that, since February, when this thing really, really took root, there's been no magic bullet. That's what I was thinking was going to happen. I thought that in March or April or, someone was going to find like what Rob found with perspective that killed NASA, basically, in with the moon passing in front of the satellite. I thought that was going to happen on the other side, or someone was going to come forward and say, all right, here's why it's a globe. Here's my proof. You guys can all shut up and go back to doing something else. And it never happened. It's September. We're getting halfway through September now. Never happened.
Well, see, and we've been carrying on with this for a few months now. So now I commit a crime. I got an insanity plea. Now it's like I go to court and it's like,
notice this? I feel like I'm taking crazy pills.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Exactly.
Well, that is a good cop out because, well, I just last week I had to have a plate and 8 screws taken out of my foot. I had surgery 2 years ago and the screws were bothering me. So I'm a lot less screwed up now than I used to be.
I don't have a drum snare or sound effect yet, but I'll have it for next week.
But I'm still out there talking about flat Earth. So how sane can I be, right?
Yeah, yeah. And what I got to throw in one more thing. There, people will come to me and they'll say, hey, look, I'm going to tell you something. And, because I get calls, probably like you do, I get calls and emails all the time. And they'll say, I'm going to tell you something, and you're going to think it's crazy. And I'll get this pause on the other side. I was going, you realize I open with flat Earth. How crazy do you think it's going to be? I can't judge anyone. I literally have to listen to every story. It's like I was molested by a transvestite alien reverse vampire. It's like I can't judge you.
I think I'm going to have to change our theme music in the second segment when we start taking calls to that call me maybe. Here's my number. You might think I'm crazy.
Nice. Nice.
Anyway.
I had 53 calls before this show.
Oh.
I know. I should the my phone number. People say, don't you regret putting out your phone number? It's like, yeah, there are days.
Yeah. Regret.
Anyway, sorry. Go ahead. What were we talking about?
No, but you know what? No, like, can I say something seriously, though? If I got a call from a Rob Skiba type or yourself, you're going to meet some interesting people around this, especially scientists and tech savvy. And you're going to get some great calls on this.
I have. And it's kind of interesting because I have received, and I'm not going to mention any names, but there's a fair number of people who have contacted me that plenty of people, if I mentioned their names, would probably know.
Barack Obama.
He was calling me the other day, about the scar on the back of his head, and never mind.
Those were three nines; they weren't sixes.
Right, that's right. Just turn your head the other way. people have been writing to me saying, look, I don't want anybody else to know that, you know, I'm looking into this too, but I got to tell you, and, you know, and there, what I think is really cool is as more and more people are starting to talk about this, it's going to become less taboo, you know, and people who are too timid to, you know, I'm too stupid. I just came right up, here's everything I'm finding. Shots from every direction. Within like 3 weeks of listening and watching Mark Sargent videos, I got almost as many videos out myself and then getting just hammered by people because it, you know, I've covered a lot of other subjects that people have gravitated toward and will send their friends, hey, you know, check out, you know, Rob Skiba's video or book or whatever on this, that, and the other thing. And then, you know, the initial response I got was, what are you doing? Now I can't send anybody to you now for all this other stuff that we like of yours because you've gone crazy, you know? Mm. And that was a lot of the early responses, and many of those people were resistant to looking into it themselves. But when they finally got over it and realized that I wasn't going to stop, they started looking into it because they're like, you know, I liked his other stuff, so maybe he's not quite as crazy as I think he is. What is he looking at? Why is he looking at this? So they started looking at it. And then other people started popping up. And I don't know if you know Zen Garcia. He's a guy that I had on my radio show a while back, and I don't know if I've been on his show or not, but anyway, we've covered a lot of the same subjects in the past, particularly the topic of the Nephilim. I happened to find like 4 videos that he had done where he was like, you know what? Yeah, I'm looking at this stuff and I got to say, guys, he was like saying all the same stuff I was saying, you know, in the beginning of it. I don't know. And then he kind of just came right out and said, you know what? I can't deny it. That's what the text says. That's what, you know, the evidence is showing. And I was floored. And so more and more people are starting to realize, you know, maybe it's a little safe to come out now, come out of the closet, if you will. And as people feel a little bit more comfortable in having the dialogue, I've had some, I'm sure Mark's had many really cool conversations. I've had some awesome conversations with people on the phone and internet exchanges and email and whatnot, where people are, as we start to put our heads together, we can solve some of the problems, you know, that you're stuck on, for instance, you know, and if we can come together and stop calling each other heretics and crazy and lunatics and, you know, all the names and everything, just let's talk, let's have a conversation. We might all actually learn something.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
On.
I've had, it is absolutely what you were saying there, Rob. It's a collective effort, and that's, and in fact, I mentioned, I think, this during the last roundtable that we had on the Baller Skeptic, and I wasn't shy about saying, I was going, look, Flat Earth is winning right now. For what, you know, every fight it goes, you do not see panels of astronomers and astrophysicists or even groups, you know, there was initially a couple groups of people in the beginning when this thing started, and they said, oh, yeah, it's crazy, blah, 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 but they never continued. They never kept going, and because there were too many topics they had to dodge. And now, yeah, everybody, the hive mind, which I like to call it, of the internet, it's starting to get on board with this because they can't, what you were saying, they can't disprove it. That, you know, everyone's looking for, it's like, you know, how can we knock this thing out? And they keep getting, all of them get sucked in one by one. Every week there's a new debunker that tries to come into this. And I watch and I go, you know, with 10, 20, 30,000 followers, I go, and I welcome them. It's like, you know what? Fantastic. You just exposed a whole bunch of people to this and you're not going to be able to solve it. And they're going to wonder why. Why didn't you knock this out of the park like you knocked other things out of the park? And, you know, that's how this thing just keeps growing.
Well, you know, I also started out in a way, you know, I was intrigued by what you had to say on Canary Cry and looked through your videos. And if it wasn't for the fact that I had already done a lot of research years ago on Admiral Byrd and the Hollow Earth stuff, I probably would not have been as receptive as I was. But I think it's your second Flat Earth clue, the Byrd Wall.
Yeah, the Byrd Wall.
Man, that one, because it had already dovetailed into things that I was already aware of, and I'm going, whoa, it's like some big missing pieces just fell into place, you know. But, you know, my cognitive dissonance kicks in, and I'm going, yeah, I got to debunk this. You know, this can't be. And the more I tried, the worse it got for me.
Yeah. Now, do you remember, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
Real quick, Jonathan, do you remember our interview was only like 4 months ago?
Yeah, it was like April 17th or something, or 15th. It was shortly after I listened to the Canary Cry one.
Yeah, and since then, so much has happened. I mean, it's just crazy the amount of traction that just keeps growing every day. And And every, I literally, I'm not kidding you when I say this, when I go into YouTube, I just type in flat earth, I set the filter to 24 hours, and it's like, I'm going, geez, I'm never going to be able to get through today's, because there's just, I can't.
Yeah, the video I did, NASA shoots itself in the foot, exposing the Apollo program as fraud. Yeah. I uploaded that pretty late at night on September 4th, so just a few days ago.
Yeah.
It's at 36,598 hits.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Holy smokes. Well, that reminds me, you know, in the fourth segment, Johnathan reminded me about the about that guy, the Dope Libs one.
Oh, yeah, we got to
bring that thing up. But yeah, it's crazy the amount of people. There's so many more people looking at it. And again, you probably have different conversations than I have, because I get a lot of conversations from some very interesting people with some really interesting stories. Most of them do not want to be anonymous. You know, they don't want to hide from this. You know, they're not quite, what, like you were saying, out of the closet yet.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's wonderful to see.
It is interesting that, I mean, I don't know what the analytics are saying right now, but it's got to be pretty huge on the Google right now. Subject.
Well, sorry, go ahead, Johnathan.
No, I just wanted to make one point. You know, it's interesting because this story, this what we're doing right now, it would make a great story for Hollywood, similar to something like the movie 23, where somebody becomes obsessed over the topic and then they start to fill in all the pieces and so on and so forth, and it totally blows up their world, you know, as the truth is revealed to them. But in bits and pieces, the whole story's been put out there for us, including like Capricorn 1 to cover the moon landing, or Gattaca to say that only the elite could go into space, or The Signal, you know, or something to show that there's a dome or dark city, you know, and there's limitations. So they've been putting it out there. And I think they do that sometimes so that if anybody uncovers the truth, they'll say, oh, you're crazy. You saw that in a movie. You're one of those nuts.
Yeah, the predictive programming for this, you know, and you and I have talked about some, like, has been going around for some years. And that kind of gives you an idea of how big it is. You know, Rob will say, I think you said several times that the reactions that you're getting, there's so much pushback in certain places that it almost screams that there's something going on.
There has to be.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you watched that video, when NASA shoots itself in the foot, but I was talking with somebody else when I was recording that, and we're talking about some of the TV shows that are out right now, and one of them is The Astronauts' Wives Club. It's on ABC. I've been watching it on Hulu. And in episode one, they set the whole thing up like, we've got to get the wives of – we got to do a whole – you know, expose on the wives and show the American public that, you know, these astronauts, they're regular guys. They have wives, they have kids, they have families, they have dogs, you know, but let's really focus on the wives and put, you know, a human family face to the space program, you know.
Yeah.
And it right as the credits are still appearing on the screen at the beginning of the show, the reporter introduces himself to the wives and says what he wants to do. And one of the wives says, sounds like we're propaganda. So, like, at the beginning of the show, they're telling you the show is propaganda. And at the end of the show, if you watch all the way to the end of the credits, after the credits go up, they show like three or four production companies that are involved with making the show. And I think it's the second or third production company that shows up. It's Fake Empire. And it's got a hand drawing of people looking up into the sky and one of the space capsules coming down with a parachute. It's their logo.
Wow.
And it's Fake Empire. And you're like, really? Seriously? Wow. And then there's another show I've been watching on Netflix called Ascension. Have you seen that?
I have seen that. It's a 10-part series on from the Sci-Fi Network. In fact, I was turned on to that by a fan of Flat Earth. And how far are you in?
I'm sorry.
It's not a 10-part series. It's a giant 2- or 3-part series. I was thinking of.
I think there might be 6 episodes, but it's whatever it is. They kind of capped it at that. I don't know if that's the end of the season.
Yeah. That's it. That was it. But did you get to the part where?
I got to the thing.
Yo, okay. So you saw it? Yeah. I saw that. I was going. You know, because I was going, why did this fan send me? You know, this thing where the spaceship was the top, the bridge of the spaceship was literally between two giant planetariums, and that all of space was being faked, and he did that little monologue thing. I was going, oh my God.
I know. I'm watching this going, holy cow. I mean, it was like kind of an amped up, cooler version of the Truman Show.
Yeah.
Like,
and,
Wow.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And there was a guy, in fact, the guy that sent me this, I go, wow, that's really cool. He goes, you know what's cool? He goes, and they'll never do it in the States, but they did it over in Great Britain because Great Britain kind of laughs at our space program, was they did a it was like a reality show called, I think, Space Cadets. And what it was kind of like a version of Punk'd, where basically they took these people, right, and they said, like, they won some sort of prize where they were going to send them into space, you know, like Virgin Galactic or SpaceX and everything.
Yeah.
And they were going to train them and do all this stuff, and they were going to put them in a capsule and black everything out, right? But the whole thing was a Punk'd. They weren't going to go anywhere.
Tonight on Space Cadets.
All right, folks. Now, you've probably been hankering to have a look down at home. See what you've been missing all these few orbits. So,
my Mark 2, 1.
There you go. All right. All right, you can stand, but just don't come any closer. But there you go, folks.
Is there a world? It's the world.
That's the world, folks.
Oh my God. Do you see land over there?
That's unbelievable.
Oh, that's what God. You've been living your whole life on.
But you can see the rain.
What's that called again?
The limb. That's the limb. Yeah.
It's the limb.
That's the envelope of air that keeps you alive down there.
Wow. Damn, guys, that is amazing.
Look, if you look right there, careful. You can see it going round. Oh, my God.
You can see, like,
there's a landmass over there.
Yeah,
where's it?
Over there.
I wonder if that's Russia.
Australia.
Roger that.
I think we're round about Australia right now.
What do you think of that, folks?
That is amazing.
That is amazing. Thanks, guys.
Oh, this is just magical, isn't it?
It's so hard to explain what I've just seen. I've just seen the whole Earth. I'll do my best. I've just seen the whole Earth, and the way I can describe it is, you know when you're on a plane and you can see straight lines in front of you, either way? I've just seen it curve, and it was just the best thing I've ever seen. And I'm just thrilled, and I'm happy, and I'm so proud that I'm lucky that I'm here.
Hang on, what's that over there on the right then? Coming up, floating up. This
is
like things float up there, I saw.
That's a goose. Well, there's a bit of dust out there that might be catching glints off the sun.
Oh,
there's a cloud here.
Everybody is on cloud 9, no pun intended. It's absolutely amazing. We've just seen the Earth. Like, I can't even believe I'm saying that sentence. We're just so happy, and I don't want to come back to Earth, actually. I want to stay up in space.
Jesus, and we're going how fast?
We're going 28,000 kilometers per hour.
Looks like we're just strolling.
And they're in a cop with a radar gun and about, 200 kilometers from us, so.
I'm speechless, sorry, I just saw the world.
I've seen pictures on the walls in the barracks and stuff, but I mean, all I see is what's around me, which is just like walls, bricks, grass and stuff. But just to see this big black space of nothingness and then just see the I think what he said was just kind of the horizon of the world. You know, like where you see the end of the sea and it's just, you know, that you sort of think that's where the world ends, or Christopher Columbus did. And I just saw that. I can't explain it. It just, it was everything I imagined and more.
Nobody's getting vertigo?
No.
I never get tired of this. I can close my eyes. I see a boat motionless on the water, all the way down there. A man hitting a duck with a stick, whatever I want. I see, but it is so far away and beautiful.
all the problems in the world just seem minor, you know that? From, like, just,
yeah, that's what they just see. It's,
yeah.
It's
they just don't mean, they
don't, like, all the wars and stuff that's going on, just seems like...
This is space in its pure form. In the pure form, there is nothing between
it doesn't seem
us
real.
And
I know,
the Earth.
I know it's real, but it just doesn't seem real.
Amazing. They were literally going to send, from what I understand, they were going to send him on a fake space mission. And I don't know if it actually aired, but they were recruiting everybody for this. I was going, I think that hit a little too close to home to where, you know, all of a sudden, you know, they think, oh, hey, I'm in orbit, right? And they open the doors. Oh, no, you're not. It's like, what? Yeah. So,
well, you know, we're getting to the point technologically, you know, where we can really fake just about anything.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. And that's why, you know, I have such a hard time with looking at video footage or still imagery, you know, and when, like, I don't know how I ended up on the White House email list, but I get this, you know, whatever update from the White House, and when they put out the new blue marble, you know, and I look at this thing.
Update or orders?
Yeah, I'm getting orders. Well, you know.
Chill.
Yeah, that's right. You know, guys like us, you know, Mark, I heard you're an Illuminati Freemason, government paid Jesuit shell. So, you know, I must be the junior officer over here.
I'm not a Jesuit.
You're not?
No, he's with the Judean People Front.
But
yes.
All the ones, yeah.
Or the People Front.
All those other titles. Right. About, come on, get it straight. No, I'm sorry. Go ahead. So you get a thing from the White House. Oh, so you got that thing when the blue marble came out.
Yeah, when it first came out, it was, you know, from the White House sent a blurb out in a Twitter or whatever to everybody. And, you know, you get this blue marble and you look at it at first, you know, it's an improvement over some of the other blue marbles. But then somebody brilliant out there decided, hey, I'm going to flip this thing upside down. And as soon as they did, the clouds are spelling sex.
Yep.
You know? And you're like,
yep.
Come on.
Yep. And you know what I also loved about that was, and Jonathan and I have talked about before, was that they were, when they put out the blue marble shot, they made a point of saying, oh yeah, by the way, this is the first blue marble shot we've done in 43 years. And
all the other ones.
Yeah, which helped the flat Earth cause, because everybody, you know, on that side was saying, you know, there are no pictures of the Earth from space. There's only one that they've ever said. And people are going, no, that's not true. And then the White House and, you know, Neil deGrasse Tyson comments on it and said, oh, yeah, this is the second shot from space in 43 years. I was going, and this doesn't bother anybody?
Yes. So wait. Do you think they're helping the cause or the movement so that they can get out from under their lies? Do you think, you know, they're giving little clues and to, you know.
That is. Go ahead.
Well, because they're still saying this is the real deal, you know.
Yeah.
They're saying that this is the ball Earth. And I think it was Neil deGrasse Tyson was saying, you know, and, you know, now with this new satellite or whatever, we're going to be getting pictures every month and, you know, new stuff. Their plan is to constantly put it in your face.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, but I will say this, and I think, you know, the movement, and, you know, especially with help from guys like you, I don't think that blue marble shot would have come out if this thing wasn't getting.
Oh, I agree.
This yep. traction. It was like I was humbled when I saw that. You know, because that blue marble thing was passed around inside our circles really, really fast, and I was going, wow, that's something. You know, you're actually going to come out and, you know, put the shot out because we've been saying that there's no shot.
Well, and then right after that is the moon crossing in front of the Earth. I mean, it was 2 weeks after that, I think that one came out. So yeah. It's almost like they're really scrambling because there's, you know, there's a guy out there called Conscious Truth on YouTube.
Okay.
It's a series, NASA Fake Images of Earth, Smoking Gun, Parts 1 through 5,
mm-hmm.
Where he's going on the NASA website, going through their image catalog, the NSSDC image catalog of the Earth, going through each of the Apollo missions and clicking on them, bringing them into Photoshop, adjusting the levels and showing the funky masks that are around them. You know, I mean, he's just hammering it. And I did a few myself. I did the same thing with Apollo 17, Scientists on the Moon. I did that on two different Google Hangout shows on video with two different people interviewing me. We did it live on the air. I took people to the site, downloaded it live, put it in Photoshop, adjusted the levels, showed them the square box or on the Earth.
Right. I saw the one you did with Josh Peck.
Yeah,
with Josh. Yeah, where you saw had the square box around the Earth that was coincidentally right underneath that pointed end of the flag. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and it was like 3 days later, I think, somebody sent me a thing on Facebook saying, go look at the same webpage that I was just on, and it said it was updated. That page was updated like 3 days after I did that show.
Really? And yeah, it's gone now?
It was updated, and I downloaded the picture again and tried it again, and I got a totally different effect. Nice. It still had pixelation around it, but they must have put a higher resolution picture and cleaned it up, because you could actually, when you adjusted the levels the same way that I did in the prior one, you could actually see stars, which you couldn't see in any of the other ones. That's so it, what it appeared is, you know, these guys are out there doing this, I'm doing this, other people are doing it, exposing these pictures, and, you know, somebody over there at NASA must have, like, they just hired a guy to go kind of clean up all the all the old stuff. Yeah. And it's like, okay, now let's get some new stuff out. Let's throw out Pluto. Yeah,
Pluto. I was just going to say, yeah, let's throw the Pluto thing out there.
Pluto. I don't know. Here's a new blue marble.
Here's a crazy sci-fi conspiracy thought for you, though. What if when they get into the upper echelons and they're revealed certain truths to them, they're in a predicament because they swore an oath, or they know there's dire consequences to them revealing it. So they're secretly, like I said, pulling for us, dropping breadcrumbs, hoping that we'll absolve them of the secrets.
Oh, you mean like if there's an evil, we'll call it alien overlord that says you cannot tell the population. If you tell the population, we're going to decimate this place.
Right.
But at the same time, it's like, okay, what can we do not to tell them, but still kind of tell them?
Right. It's like you're in, you know, you're there and you're at a symposium or you're at some conference and you're you know, and the guys are there debunking it. Meanwhile, the guy's kicking like information to you under the desk, you know, like pick it up, like ixnay on the flat earth, eh?
Well, you know, and I've thought that a few times, just because, you know, some of their screw-ups, and Rob's seen them, you know, some of NASA's screw-ups recently have been so horrible. You know, they cross the border into negligence and, you know, blatant screw-ups. It's like almost like they're dumbing it down to the lowest common denominator, you know, that's out there, because they have to, you know, like they want the general public, you know, not people in the conspiracy world, but people, you know, people that are watching Dancing with the Stars on a regular basis. No offense if you guys watch that, but but they're doing that just so, you know, even you have a Joe Lunchbox is going to go, hey, that moon photo doesn't look quite right. You know, one of those things.
Right.
Well, let's I'll tie this back again to predictive programming. Do you remember the series Dark Skies on NBC?
Yeah, sure. I think it's still running.
Yeah, I think
no,
so.
Is it?
Spielberg produced part of that thing, right?
The alien grays came down. They made a deal with Eisenhower and all that, and they showed the whole history. And it was set in the 50s or 60s. I think it was set in the 60s. Are we talking about the same one?
No. Dark Skies was the Spielberg series that basically a post-apocalyptic aliens run around and human beings are trying to scrounge for
Noah Wiley, something like that, is the main guy.
Yeah, oh, that was it. Okay, yeah. I thought there was another one called Dark Skies. Well, the series I'm thinking of was basically just showing you the whole Project Blue Book and the supposed deals with the alien greys and so on and so forth.
Sure.
And again, I'm thinking, like, what if that was really the true story? And the military knows the precarious position they're in because of, you know, underground bases or whatever the heck, you know, they're controlling. And if they let the cat out of the bag, it would create, you know, panic and destruction and, you know.
Yeah, I could see that. It feels, though, like the cat's already coming out of the bag.
Right.
And there's nothing they can do to stop it. That's what I mean. And you know me, I can spin doom and gloom like anyone, but I'm excited every time I look at this thing, because the speed and the momentum and the amount of it's expanding in breadth and depth. It's just amazing. And again, nobody's shooting it down. You know, where are the panels? You would think that some astrophysicists, you know, some small-time players would get together, form some sort of roundtable, invite a flat earther on there, and just beat on them as much as they could. Because the Art Bell thing, you know, wasn't nearly as bad as it could have been.
Well, you know what the sad irony is, too? If that were the truth, people would say, oh, my God. Remember the good old days when the New World Order were the ones you had to worry about?
Oh.
And the aliens come out.
Yeah. And I'm sorry. And by the way, Rob, you would have been a great choice for the Art Bell show as well.
I only saw or only listened to the one where the Morgyle or whatever.
Morgyle, yeah.
Yeah. Is that the one you're talking about?
Yeah, yeah. You know, if you don't know the little story about it, David Weiss tells it way better than I do. But basically, Eric Dubé was initially shoulder tapped for it, and the producer for the Art Bell show was kind of riding him quite a bit, and you know me, I don't back Eric that many times, but I saw the letters in his forum, and they look pretty legit, And Eric kind of called their bluff and said, look, if you're going to keep, you know, giving me crap, why don't you just find us another guy? And they said, fine, we will. and so they started looking around, but they didn't call Jaronism. They didn't call me. I don't think they tried Matt. And so they called David, and Dave was like hunting around somebody last minute, and they got the Morgyle. And, you know, and what I love, and silver lining, and Johnathan, I talked about this briefly. Here's the silver line, which I love about this story.
You got 15 seconds. Go for it.
Okay. Was that a flat earther, even a guy, a rookie in interviews, challenged it and said, you know what? I'll go up against Art Bell.
Back, everybody, to Perception Truth Talk Radio. And I want to thank Rob and Mark for helping me fly this ship. Even though I only have a low ceiling and I can't go far into space with it, it feels good to be the captain of it.
Nice. Well said.
There you go. Well said. I'm going to let you guys talk more because I ad-lib too much, but this is we got a lot of stuff to cover yet. So
okay,
let's pick up with the Morgyle.
I want to mention this real quick because I think it bears repeating. And that is what I liked about the Morgyle thing is that he had never done any interviews. And when he was shoulder tapped, this shows you the confidence of the flat earth movement. You know, there's no wavering. When he was shoulder tapped and said, hey, would you like to be on the Art Bell show? By the way, you're going to go after an astrophysicist who is a radio veteran. How do you feel about that? Yeah, put me in, coach. how does that happen? You know, there should be guys who would just run away, you know, screaming, no. And he didn't even waver. Got on there. I mean, yeah, he didn't do great. You know, made some rookie mistakes, and you hate to see it. But at the same time, it's like he got in there.
I got to give the guy credit because, yes, there was things. I was yelling at the radio, say this. This is so easy. but the show is heavily biased against him. I mean, I can't. There were so many times when that obnoxious scientist dude cut him off.
Yeah.
And Art was clearly favorable to the scientist guy. So, I mean, the few times that the Morgyle guy got to actually talk, you know, I think he did pretty good. But, I mean, he never got to finish a sentence, never got to finish what he was – his thought. I mean, the guy kept talking about the – was it the circle of the earth navigation or whatever. I'm like, yeah, exactly. On a flat earth map, it's a straight line.
Yeah.
I'm yelling at the radio like, ah! Because they kept what the argument was. There was one argument. I think that was it. But one of them, they kept saying the same argument like over and over and over again. Like it was their trump card or something. I'm like, that's an easy one, you know.
Yeah.
But they wouldn't let him talk. But if that's his first time out, and first time out going out to millions of people on the Art Bell show, kudos.
Yeah.
I give a lot of credit.
Yeah, and what you were saying, most of the people, the other great thing about the flat earth is that it's fairly open-ended in terms of some of the concepts, you know, the exact shape, you know, how high is the dome, is there a dome, isn't there a dome, but everyone pretty much agrees it's not a globe, so everyone knows the material now, which is great. You could shoulder tap a whole bunch of people now, and they pretty much are in line with a lot of different things. He didn't do great, but same. Yeah. First time out. Are you kidding?
He did. You know, I give it to him. He had a lot better composure than I would have had. I would not have responded well to the antagonism that was shown there.
You think you would have gotten a little hot?
Well, I'm the type of person, I'm going to reflect back to you whatever energy you're giving to me. You know, we're having a cordial conversation right now. That's what you're getting, you know.
Yeah, but they would have probably lowered your mic or something.
Probably.
Yeah, they like to.
They were getting really. I mean, there's a lot of backhanded insulting. You know, they were doing everything they can to make the guy look as stupid as they could.
Yeah.
And
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Well, I was gonna say it was poor radio, in my opinion.
Yeah.
The way it was done.
It was also interesting that out of all the interviews that have been done by everybody that's been doing this, that was really the first one that went after the topic itself. You know, where they, and I thought that was surprising. That up until now, that's another fun thing about this movement, is that everyone that's been, you know, all the podcasts and everybody out there that's been, you know, been doing stuff, they haven't been, they kind of do what you're, you know, doing, you know, you kind of laugh at first, but then when you realize it's serious, then you're like, wow, this is really, really interesting, because they think it's brand new. They say, this is really fresh topic. This is really exciting to talk about. And it's like, it's the oldest topic there is. It's just that nobody's been bringing it up for 500 years.
Well, you know, that statement right there, 500 years, because I said the same thing. If you go to my website, testingtheglobe.com, there's a new section that I started to work on, and I haven't been able to find the time to finish it yet, but the gearing up for Apollo section there. I got Architects of a Spherical World, Examining an Ancient Motive, and A Time of Change and the Death of God. Those are three blogs that I've written on it so far, and I've got the other ones in partial stages of completion. But what I came to realize, especially after reading Zetetic Astronomy, 100 Reasons Earth Not a Globe, and Terra Firma, Earth Not a Planet, Proved from Scripture, Fact, and Reason. These books were written at the end of the 1900s, or at the end of the 1800s, and the beginning of the 1900s. So even as you're turning into the beginning of the 20th century, there were people out there taking a stand on what we would call the old school belief. Now, it is true in academia, because the sciences from the time of, probably from Copernicus forward, certainly after Newton, started to get heavily skewed into the gravity model, the heliocentric globe model, and all that. And the more it started getting pushed in various forms of education, it's just pumping out children after children, where that's all they've ever known. So that's where it sort of took over. But it really wasn't a cut and dry case for the past 500 years, I'm finding. Finding there was still a remnant of the voices crying in the wilderness, kind of like, we're doing now, right into the beginning of the 20th century.
Where they were just hanging on. Yeah, yeah. And you're right. I probably shouldn't. Let me rephrase part of my statement there. The map that I initially gravitated to was, and I don't give him enough credit, was the Orlando Ferguson map of 1830. Where, he was a big flat earth guy, and said that, it was shaped sort of, I'm not supposed to say roulette table anymore because that whole numerology thing, but it had some warps and curves, but it was basically a flat model, and he was really preaching it pushed it out there. So yeah, you're right. There's always been some people talking about it. But up until now, it hasn't, but the media never really, paid any attention to it, even alternative media. And now it is. Go ahead.
With that Gleason standard map, 1892.
Oh yeah.
That one absolutely blew me away, because that's pulled from the Boston Library.
Yep.
This is like a government that appears to be sanctioned map, standard map of the world, and right at the top of it says of the projection of the Earth, and it says scientifically and practically correct as it is. It's right at the top of the map.
Yeah.
1892, government sanctioned map. You're like, what?
yeah, you're right. There's copies of these, and again, the internet misses nothing. It's great that it sticks. Once somebody, all it takes is one person to find a little nugget like that, and they put it out there, and then it just spreads like wildfire, which is great. I have a couple copies of that map lying around, which is fantastic. Yeah. Oh, I've got to ask you, Rob. I know, or maybe you caught the two questions for you real quick. I know you probably caught the Kent Hovind Forbes article. Did you catch when in Forbes magazine,
made it to Forbes. The subject made it to Forbes.
Yeah, the subject made it to Forbes in kind of like a little glancing blow sort of way, where it's like, Kent Hovind's getting problems, having difficulties with his followers, but not in a way you might think. And they actually mentioned Flat Earth in the title.
Right.
I was going, well, you guys shouldn't have said that. But then the latest one that came out was that 2 weeks ago, Johnathan, I can't remember, where Newsweek did a story on Pluto truthers. That they actually coined that name because there were people saying that Pluto was all the pictures were fake, and then they went into the whole NASA thing. But they instead of bringing up the whole flat earth thing, they were calling it Pluto truthers. Now, what was interesting about that article was they mentioned him in name and his work, and they obviously interviewed him. Was Newsweek interviewed Crow?
Wow.
Crow 777. And I was going, and they didn't, you would have thought, it's like, okay, so you're going to interview Crow for two or three paragraphs, and they're going to have an astrophysicist come in and end the article and just destroy him. And they didn't. And I was going, what is going on? Why are these little stories starting to come out, more and more? And, the fact the mainstream's touching them, it's fantastic.
It seems like, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Do you know
Chuck Missler?
Do you know who Dr. Chuck Missler is?
Yeah, no? He's excellent. He used to work for Western Digital. He's an intelligent, incredible guy.
Somebody just sent me while we were talking a link to, he's got a website, Koinonia House, and under his science section, it says, "Attention all Flat Earth Society members," by Dr. Chuck Missler. It says, "Calling all Flat Earth Society members, don't throw away your historical credentials. It now turns out that your perceptions may have been even more extensive than previously suspected. Not only the Earth, but the entire universe may be flat." And then he goes on to talk about, he's been talking about the holographic universe for quite some time. But it's interesting that, I mean, a guy like Chuck Missler coming out and making a statement like that.
When was this?
It looks like there's no date on it, but it looks like it was fairly recently.
Wow.
That's interesting. Now I got to look that up.
It says, this article, I'll put a link in the Skype. It says, this article was originally published in the July 2015. So just a couple months ago.
Wow. That's great.
By the way, Mark, you know, even though it's leaking out and it's, you know, been on Art Bell and they did a hit piece on that, I think they're going to keep trying to control it. I mean, they're going to let a little bit out, just like fishing, you know, let out the line a little bit and see who bites, and then put out a hit piece, put another miserable Art Bell show. I mean, I've lost respect for him. I used to listen to him every night. But until somebody like you or Rob or somebody gets, you know, true exposure.
Well, there's a paradox there, and we should probably, let's segue from that into the dope libs thing.
I was just going to bring that up. Yeah.
Because we got to tell Rob about
that. Bizarre.
Yeah. But the paradox is they have a really hard time. They're kind of stuck in a way because controlling it, unfortunately, social media now has more power than the mainstream media. You know, in certain ways. So because you can't let the story just come out on CNN, otherwise it's game over. You know, the whole thing, you know, that everyone will start talking about it. But if you let it keep seeping around social media and spreading the way it's been happening, then what's going to happen is by the time the mainstream media kind of touches it, it's going to be old news. People are going, yeah, I already heard about it. You know, we watched all the YouTube videos. But to answer your thing, or to kind of build on what Rob said, so the movement's been talking about no pictures of the Earth from space, and all of a sudden they come up with this miraculous satellite, you know, the new blue marble shot, and oh, by the way, there's the moon, you know, just pass by, don't blink or you'll miss it. And then when you were doing analyzing the Apollo 17 or whatever, 15, 16, 17, the photographs with Photoshop, and you found all the things, and all of a sudden they started changing it because you were doing it, right? The YouTube thing, Jonathan and I watched the other night, and most people don't know this, and if you've been following Flat Earth, you may have picked up on it. There is a new number one Flat Earth video out there. It's a con video. You know, it's not pro, it's con.
This cracks me up more than the moon like being colder. Go ahead.
Because we watched it happen, which was weird. I you know, because I check every day, 24, you know, 20 hours, I'm going to look and I see these hits. And there was this guy who made like a 9-minute video. Okay, so there, just so you know, Rob, you have kind of an equivalent of yourself in England. At least from what I've seen, his name's his YouTube handle is Tiger Dan 925. You ever heard of this guy?
I think so. Is he a guy that was freaking out when I put my when I took my site down?
He could have been. He's a strong Christian, and he made a 5-part series of how why the flat Earth is right. You know, and it was a beautifully done series. He's got now, I don't know, 20,000 subscribers, and he was doing really well.
Cool.
So he makes this 5-part series, and then another guy comes along, and his handle is Dope Libs. So Dope and then Libs, or Dope Lives. I think it's Libs. And he makes basically a 9-minute video, and he's also British, from what I can tell. And he just starts, and the whole thing is just him laughing over the, so he's showing Tiger Dan's video, and he's just laughing over the, you know, how those irritating people, it's, you know, he's just cackling over everything, you know, and any flat earth proposal, he's just laughing at it. Now, that part isn't interesting. What was interesting was it was getting a whole bunch of hits. Now, this guy did have 100,000 subscribers, no question. But every video he's made over the last, I don't know, 3-4 months, and you can look this up if you want, is getting maybe 1,000 hits, 2,000 hits. Basically, he's running at about 1-2% retention. He was kind of a big deal like 5 years ago, but not so much now. But he was getting a whole bunch of hits. And I was looking, and I thought it was really interesting. So I sent Jonathan an email. I go, look at this guy's video. It's been out 13 hours, and it's got 90,000 hits.
Yeah, right? I'm like, what are you talking about? It's like at 150,000.
Exactly.
Like,
I sent that email, and I go to get to the kitchen to get some food, right? And I'm eating. I finish my food. It did not take long. And I come back, and Jonathan says, what are you talking about? It's 150. You mean the one with 150,000 hits? And I'm going, wait a minute, wait a minute. And we look, and it just keeps going up.
And the constant 95%, 96% thumbs up rating. And
Yeah. With these
disproportionate
weird
amount of comments.
Yeah, the duration. Yeah,
and there was what's it called? His channel is Dope Lives.
Dope Lives. Well, you don't even have to do that.
Is it Dope Lives or Dopey Lives?
Dope Lives. You don't even have to do that. Just type in Flat Earth and set the filter to nothing.
Yes.
And you'll see it. It'll be like number two or number one. It'll be number one. But the point was, here's what happened. There was a point there where John, I'm just staring at this thing. I'm just getting angrier and angrier because I could see what's happening. It jumped about 200,000 hits in maybe, what, 2.5 hours? Maybe?
Yeah, I think it topped out at around 450,000 hits.
That's
yeah.
what I just looked at it right now. 453,627
views. Yeah. And
in 2 days.
During that time where it jumped 200,000 hits in like a couple hours, there were no comments, no additional comments.
No, wait. Keep this in proper perspective. The famous Star Trek song of the fight scene between Kirk and Spock.
Yeah.
In 5 years, that thing only got like 362,000 hits. That's a famous Star Trek song.
Yeah.
And this one stupid video of a guy laughing got 400 something thousand in 2 days.
Hits. Yeah. But yeah, absolutely right. Yeah. 400,000 hits in 2 days. It was ridiculous. And we were watching this thing going, it was so artificial. You could tell somebody.
But people questioned it.
Oh, yeah.
They said the same thing. Like, how did you get all these hits, like, just from a Reddit link? Like, where's that link that all these people came here?
Yeah. And it was obvious that whoever was behind the scenes, whoever was pulling the strings here, they wanted to make sure this thing was number one with a bullet as far as, you know, as far as popularity and trending in Flat Earth. And even the guy who made it said, you know, it's like, you know, that was part one. He made part two and part three. Part two got what, maybe 40,000 hits. Part three got like 30,000 hits, 90% drop off. And then he quit. Then he just dropped
out. And that doesn't make sense, because if you look at the comments, they're like, oh, this is the funniest thing I ever saw. I watched it 5 times, 10 times.
Yeah.
You know, out of curiosity alone, those people should have been looking at part two or three and said, oh my God, this has to be, you know, better than the first, or let's see what he does for a repeat, you know, performance and encore.
He's got my clip of the Josh Peck show showing that right at 1:10 in.
On which, the part one or part two?
Part one of three.
Yeah. Yeah, it was amazing. But the point I was getting at was, this is the first time I've actually seen them delve artificially into the YouTube side of things. And they were showing me what you can really do. You know, it's like you want to
Well, they
see
mess with the numbers all the time. I mean, come on.
Well, yeah. People have always suspected them doing it. But this one was like, you know, we're not even going to mask it a little bit. Let's just go, you know, big chunks. Boom, boom, boom. Okay, here's your number one Flat Earth video. Go run with that. But the guy got greedy, and he, instead of, you know, because I'm sure the guy that made it didn't have a clue either, but he made number two and number three, and then after that he stopped doing Flat Earth videos. You know,
Maybe Diebold runs YouTube.
Ah, good like one from that documentary. Yeah,
the way they take the vote count
from the voting machines documentary. Yeah. Anyway, the point was what I was showing you there is it was it was blatant. And it was responsive, meaning they're trying to hit anything they can to see if they can, you know, part of me thinks they were trying to distract from the movement. Part of me thinks, okay, maybe now that it's got 400,000 hits, maybe they're going to recommend it to other people. But it's a bad video to recommend because it's a con. And
You know what we forgot to look at? We were looking at what they wanted us to look at. You know, we were mesmerized by the same thing. Yeah. We didn't look at the periphery and to see what in the past few days prior to that may have been a trigger, may have been too close to the truth, that could have been the tipping point.
Yeah.
Because they got nervous, obviously, and they pushed us out here too hard for distraction.
September 3rd, looks like, that was released.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, most of those hits and most of the 400-something thousand hits were done in the first 24 hours.
Yeah.
And, it you know, and that's what, you know, we're just laughing because it's like, you know, some of Eric Dubé's videos would have like 280,000 hits, but it's taken months.
Yeah. And a whole society with a chat room, a forum.
Yeah. And it was all pro. You know, this was a con video. Con videos get destroyed. And this thing had a 95% approval rate. Not a chance. You know, and some of the comments were ridiculous. I mean, that one comment I read to you, Jonathan, was like, they said, oh, yeah, I laughed for hours. So when you talk about the video,
and you know, you can use as other, you can use it as other benchmarks. You can go to College Humor or places, you know, where there's a lot of subscribers the same, and just see what they average on any given video.
Yeah.
Like again, 440-something-odd thousand in 2 days. Like really?
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway,
that's an anomaly.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's great because how many conspiracies do you actually see? And I'll throw this back at you, Rob, where it's responsive. We always joke about the authority and the powers that be and they and them, you know, and they always seem to ignore and shrug off just about every conspiracy you can think because it's not going to change anything. But they seem to be responding to this one pretty quick. You agree?
Yeah. I mean, it is amazing just in every way how this is just taking off like crazy wildfire. I mean, if it was so easy to debunk, this would have died a long time ago.
Yeah. Yeah. Go ahead.
I was going to say one thing, you know, looking at your numbers, Mark, and it's not a numbers game for those that are really doing the work. Yours are kind of low. And I'm wondering if inversely they've kept your numbers lower so that people don't get attracted to your first 10 clues. Same thing with Rob. I wonder if maybe, you know what I mean?
No, Rob's getting hits, but he's also catching the grief.
I've got all your videos linked on my site. I got a whole section on the website that's just flat earth videos from different people. Yeah. And it's hard to keep up because like you said, more and more are coming out and a lot of them are really good. I've watched like the Morgyle. I was introduced to his stuff a few months ago, probably a month after yours. And he had some good stuff. And another guy put out the biggest lie or something.
The greatest lie. Yeah.
Yeah, that was good. There's several of them that have been out and more coming out. But I saw one of the guys, I don't know if it was that same guy that Tiger Dan or who it was, but when I pulled my, because I pulled the site down too, I put the Phil Collins song, I Don't Care Anymore.
Oh, I remember that. When you did it. Jonathan and I were talking about it. And I was going, man, he better come back.
I don't care anymore. I was,
yeah, good choice.
Song over and over and over again because I was like, yeah, that's what I was feeling.
Yeah.
So this one guy, he did a video and he's like, you know, I don't know what's going on guys, but a lot of these flat earth videos are either being set to private or being deleted. And then there's this one guy, Rob Skiba. I mean, look what his whole site came down. He's like, we better download all the videos before everything's gone. You know, I'm like, so I was looking at that cause when I saw what he did, I was like, oh wow. You know, I didn't think I had any, that kind of a following or anything, but
yeah,
I was kind of excited about that, but at the same time I was going, you know what, there is something going on, because I did see about the same time I was done, there were several people, it was that whole week there was like three or four other guys out there that either pulled videos completely, deleted them, because I saw them disappear on my site. They went blank, you know, the embedded videos were blank, or some of the other ones were set to private. So I'm kind of like, I mean, I know what happened to me. I just had so much family stuff going on and physical health problems and just a lot of drama on my own.
Yeah.
And nobody was getting to me. You know, it's like, it wasn't like the man got to me, you know. Yeah. But, you know, I don't know if that's the same deal with these other guys or not. But it was weird that one, that for that period of time, mid-August, I'd see a big shift where a lot of people were dropping out.
Yeah, yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about, because I, you know, most of the information I get is because people will email me and say, oh, did you hear? Did you hear? And I was like, you know, and I'm looking, and they're checked out this link. Have you seen it yet? And the link's like 30 minutes old. I'm going, dude, I know I have not seen this yet. And so I heard about you. I had, literally about 25, 30 people emailing me about you.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And no, it's okay. They're going, no, Rob quit. I'm going, yeah, yeah, I've heard this record before. He did not quit. You know, he just doesn't, he's not completely going to commit to the flat earth thing. And they go, no, he quit. The site's down. And so at the same time, a couple other people were coming out and saying, no, there's stuff being, I heard the same thing you did, and there's stuff being pulled down. And sure enough, when I go through, because every once in a while I'll go through my liked section, I've got one liked list, you know, and I start going through it, and there were a bunch of deleted or private videos in there. And I thought, well, that's kind of odd. And I didn't know who they were, obviously, because they were already killed off. But I thought that was really strange. Now, did there seem to be some thinning of the ranks? Yeah. Yeah, some, but I don't know if it was a coincidence or, you know, because all the bigger players, from what I can tell, nobody dropped out.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, your timing couldn't have been worse. Because
I know. But during that time, I actually ended up connecting with Matt Boylan, and we had some interesting dialogue kind of behind the scenes. You know, he doesn't believe in the dome thing.
Yeah, I know.
He believes in the infinite plane, but I said, what? Because he thinks, you know, you've got a really small God if, you know, God just created this little Truman Show.
Sure.
I said, well, no, there's nothing that says that he couldn't have created more Truman Shows. I mean, what if we're, you know, what if your egg crate idea is every bit as legitimate as you want it to be, but they just have domes over them?
Yeah.
You know, and there's the scripture in John 14:2, it says, in my Father's house, Jesus is talking, in my Father's house are many mansions. The Greek word there is monē or something like that, dwelling places. Yeah. If it were not so, I would have told you. So who's to say that there aren't more dwelling places just like this one?
We're down to the last few seconds of the show, but Mark, is there a chance we can talk to Rob again on Saturday night? Because this is awesome, and there's more to talk about.
Absolutely, we're going to talk to Rob again on Saturday night. You up for it, Rob?
Yeah, man. Yeah.
All right, okay. So we're going to do Strange World. Go ahead, Jonathan, take us out.
Yeah, no, I just want to thank everybody for the first live show. I had two incredible guys with me to make it spectacular, and yeah, we're going to cover a lot of topics like this. Next time we'll have call-ins. We'll set that up soon, so all the wackadoos out there listening can call in. Rob, 5 seconds. Any last words?
Well, I would just say, do your own investigation. Don't just push it off.
Thank you, everybody. We'll see you soon.
Frequency Radio is your number one source for news and information without the hate, hype, and fear. We are proud to bring you cutting-edge programs like The Kev Baker Show,
The Christopher Everard Show,
The Freedom Link with Joe Joseph,
Truth Frequency with Chris and Shuri Geo,
Strange World
with Mark Sargent,
X-Squared with Brooks Agnew,
Down the Rabbit Hole with Popeye,
Freaky Friday
with The Woo Crew,
Waking Up the Masses
with Robert Bruce,
Phoenix Rising Radio,
and dozens more.
Did you know you can listen from any computer, mobile device, or from any telephone by dialing 832-225-5308.
Or call into your favorite show toll-free at 866-37-TRUE.
Uncensored talk and news you won't hear in the mainstream media.
24 hours a day.
Truth Frequency Radio. Wherever you are, make it TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
With SRN News, I'm Patrick Fox.